to be able to gather together with God's people, if you would just stand with me, this is a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just want to praise you and thank you for such a beautiful day. Lord, we want to thank you for the service that we had this morning and how you came and how you moved. But Lord, this is another service. This is a different time. And Lord, we just pray that you would just come. Settle down upon us. Help us to feel your spirit walking up and down the aisle. Fill us with your joy and with your grace and mercy. Lord, reach out to those that are not here and those that are being watching on the live stream, whatever it is, wherever they are, Lord, just reach out and touch them and help them to know that you are and will always be your God, that you love them, and that you will be there with them and strengthen them. Father, just go with us through the rest of this service and just help us to just feel your spirit. It's Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So remain standing with us.
Our love is growing, though it's fresh joy.
Don't forget about our outreach ministries, no bait, bait sale. And you said to purchase some new media equipment and help with live streaming. And we'll just do those things to do God's will and God's word. The nomination dollars will be returned today. If you haven't done that, please do so. On July 12th, we'll have a board meeting service following the morning service, board meetings, and then an annual business meeting and funeral service that evening. On July 17th, 18th, we'll have a church yard sale for church extension. And then on the 17th, district council meeting, and 18th through the 26th is Mitchin Camp. So lots to do, lots to plug into. We have plenty of work to do. And didn't say this morning, but you are here tonight. We don't want to give our offerings. So offering plates are in the back. We want to do that in the service, and that'd be very greatly appreciated. So let's join together now, and let's just raise our voices to the Lord. We'll sing another hymn. This is it. bad feeling when it happens this time. It's not going to be a slow thing. It's going to be all at once, and it's going to be a prolonged. I just have that feeling that God's going to have His way in all of this.
Amen.
He's going to reach out to people. He's going to reach out to people, good people like you and I, that aren't afraid to stand and proclaim the word and to witness and to tell the world with the love of Jesus. We just love you so much. For those of the prayer requests that you already know, is there any new prayer request in mind? I'm telling you, already let us know.
Lord Jesus, thank you
for being you. Thank you for leading us along. We especially appreciate that you never walk far in front of us. You always leave a clear footpath. But then we glance and you're beside us to our left. Another time we see your footprints and the path that we notice and you're there at our right. And then sometimes, Lord, we know you're at our back because we feel you watching and taking care of what's back there. Or just watching our back. We thank you, Lord, that you are the Lord, that you can be in all places. We thank you that you are all-knowing. We're continually finding things that we don't know that you put in the book years ago. Thank you, Lord, for being you. We look forward to what you have ahead in this life for each of us. But we look forward to the Sunday evening of time when we come see the land that you prepared and join you in all the majesty of the new heaven and the new earth. What a day. What a day. Help us be on the road. Help us journey on in the path that we should go. We pray these blessings, Lord, and we ask that you would speak to any that are not at one with you, any that haven't had their sins forgiven, Lord. Call them, draw them, help them submit to you. We pray for the sick. We pray for those having surgery. We ask blessings upon those who are approaching the end of this world and crossing to the next world. We ask blessings upon all your creation in the blessed name of Jesus.
Big valley that we have to.
If you looked someone's husband. And she's a sinner. But then after the Lord gets through with her and forgives that and sends her out the other way, she's a Christian. But on the day she got caught, it looked pretty bad, didn't it? What about if you met Mary Magdalene and she had 7 demons in her? I don't know what Mary Magdalene was like, but she had 7 demons. Then after the Lord met her, she was a Christian and had Him in her and was able to be a Christian from there on out and a great witness for the Lord. What about if you stop in on Joseph and he's pacing the floor saying, I'll put her away privately, that's what I'll do. I don't want to have a woman that's with another man's job. But then in a few days after the angel has talked to him, he said, Mary, I need to take you as my wife, but I won't know you until after God's son is born. God makes the difference, though. Makes the difference to the sick. And Christians, there are times we're in the valley. And there are times when we're down and we don't look to it. I want you to turn your Bibles, if you would, to Matthew. No, it's the 20th chapter. Matthew, the 20th chapter. And we're getting, in the things I want us to look at tonight, we're getting close to the end of Christ's life here on earth. So we're talking about men. We're going to pick a little bit on Peter and James and John, since they were the inner circle. You know, the Lord gives us certain friends to travel with through this world. We have a large group of acquaintances. A company, he called them, like a great cloud of witnesses. If you've been in the church very long, there's a great cloud of witnesses that you know. But the number gets smaller of the ones you've really worked one-on-one with. And the number gets even smaller of those that, for whatever reason, the Lord puts you together to work. And the Lord had similar things. He worked with everybody. He had 70 he called at one time. He had 12 he walked especially with. And then he began trusting Peter, James, and John even closer than that. So let's look at that tonight. Sometimes I think the devil climbs on us and tries to destroy us. He tries to kill us. He tries to steal from us. If you're not in a valley tonight, you will be in a valley someday. And Christians have time. I don't care how strong you are. There are times the devil comes to your house. Amen. Comes to your head. It comes to your heart, your soul, your mind, your life. Probably the hardest battle that Roger and I ever had as Christians was the year that after 40 years of pastoring that I had a small stroke, and he had a back surgery and ended up with staph after it, almost dying, and we literally could not minister. And we were lost. We were literally lost. We thought our time was over. We thought the Lord was finished with us. And we mourned. I think he mourned even more than me, because he likes to get out there and find people and invite them. His ministry is inviting you to church. And I heard him say to God, how many people during that time? I don't even have a church to invite them to. I'm not able to get out of his chair. I'm not able to go anywhere. And it was a low valley. And we thought, well, it's over. it's jobs or finances. Sometimes it's our children or our families. Sometimes it's our churches in trouble. But we have times when we don't look as healthy spiritually. We don't count us out yet. Don't make the mistake of counting us out. In Mark. Now these two little boys don't look too good today. They don't look too good at all. Then, Mark 20:20. Then came to Jesus, the mother of Zebedee's children, with sons. Mama and the boys have come to see Jesus. Now you Bible readers are already ahead of it. Now this family's been doing some talking. And you probably wouldn't have been proud if you'd have heard the conversation. Then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him. Now that's a little bit of a hidden motive. But they worshiped him. They talked about how he was the Son of God and how they appreciated him as Savior. Part of that is because they want his power and authority to do something. And desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, what wilt thou? Pardon me. She said unto him, he said, what would you like? What do you want? She said unto him, grant that these, my two sons, James and John, my two sons may sit, the one on thy right hand and the other on thy left, in thy kingdom. Now, Wilma's version of that is this. Well, you see, we were home talking, Jesus. We were just kind of sitting around talking. And we know that you've been saying that you have to die and rise again, and then you're going back to your to heaven, and that you're going to create a kingdom. And we were just thinking, you know, it seems like you kind of prefer James and John anyhow. And we've noticed from time to time that you pick them when you need special things. You know, like they got to go to the Transfiguration, them and Peter. And we noticed that sometimes when you go to a special healing, like the girl that everybody thought was dead, that you went to heal and to raise from the dead, that you only let Peter and James and John go in with you. So we know you're already kind of, you prefer them. And we were kind of talking. And we were wondering, when you get to your kingdom, could James sit on one side and John the other? Now that doesn't sound like too shocking a request until you remember there are 12 disciples. And until you remember that only one of them is unfaithful. So at least 11 of the disciples, but they have figured out it would best be served to be us. Now I don't think they look too good today. What about you? I think they look a little selfish. I think they look a little power hungry. I think they look a little bit like, if there's anybody who deserves those seats, me. All you teachers, we've seen that, haven't we? That one goes, me. But Jesus said unto them, you know not what you eat. Are you able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of? And to be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with? He's referring to the cross and the baptism of the cross. And he said unto them, ye shall indeed drink of my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with. You're actually going to suffer for the kingdom. You're going to drink the cup just of men's sins and of preaching and doing what you need to do. Think about who we're talking about here, James and John. You're going to be baptized with a baptism of suffering for the sins of people. You remember James is going to be, he's going to be beheaded. He's going to be the first apostle beheaded. And John is going to live long enough that he's going to be, even as an old man, out on the Isle of Patmos as a prisoner. He said, you're going to drink of the cup. You're going to suffer from the kingdom. You're going to be baptized with the baptism. But it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared. But to sit on my right hand and on my left, it's not mine to give. You're asking me for something that isn't even mine to give. It shall be given to them for whom it is prepared of my Father. You're so far out of the will of the Lord, boys. You're not even in the will of the Lord. You don't look too good today, James. You don't look too good today, John. You're giving me a selfish, biased request that you with each other and with your mother. This has been part of the conversation you all had. And then you cooked it up, so to speak, to come and see if I would give it to you. And you're so far out of the will of the Lord, you don't realize it could have said the right hand seat is mine. That's my seat. This is God's, and we're never clearly, that I know of, if you know teach me, we're never clearly told who this seat is. But perhaps it's the Holy Spirit's. He said, you're asking for something. It is not even mine to give. Have you ever been so far out of the will of the Lord that you're asking things that are not in the will of the Lord? Have you ever just gotten selfish and just simply said, I want this or I want that? It's human. It's human for us. And these boys don't look too good today. They don't look too good. And if we would turn over then to Matthew. No, that's not Matthew. We'll go to Mark. In Mark, listen to Peter, James, and John again. It's kind of a... Well, just listen to it. Trying to figure out where to start. Mark 14:32. And they came to a place which was called Gethsemane. And he saith to his disciples, now there's 11 of them, Judas is already gone. Sit ye here while I shall pray. And he taketh with him Peter and James and John, and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. And he saith unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. Tarry ye here and watch. He said, best friends, my very inner circle, I need you to know that I am so sorrowful. My load is so heavy. Would you pray with me? And he went forward, the other writers tell us about a stone's throw, and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt. And he cometh and findeth them sleeping. Have you ever needed somebody to really get in there with you and help you on a spiritual matter, and you just couldn't seem to get them away? You just couldn't seem to get them away. Jesus looks at his disciples, and his main problem is they are just sleepy. They're just so sleepy that they are simply, wherever he's left them, he's left the main group at one place, he's brought the three on farther, and then every time he comes back, and between Matthew and Mark and Luke, between the gospel writers, they share with you that he prayed three times. And every time he prayed, he found them asleep. And the third time when he went to pray, the Bible says that God sent an angel to strengthen him. So he's facing the crucifixion. He's facing the death on the cross. And he's in a man's body that's going to have to be killed. And he needs strength to be able to face it. And his best friends are just sleeping. They just can't seem to wake up. They don't look too good tonight, people. The night that Jesus is going to be arrested, they are so sleepy, they just never, ever are able to stay awake and pray with the Master. And even though he comes back to them the three times, each time he finds them asleep. And he tells them this. He doesn't get angry with them. He doesn't yell at them. He doesn't call them unfaithful disciples. He doesn't say, well, you're flimsy, you're weak. But he does tell them, you need to be willing to pray because your spirit is willing, but your flesh is weak. Your spirit is willing, but your flesh is weak. They don't look too good, do they? And if you follow them a little closer, later in the night, after Judas has come and kissed the Lord, and after Peter has cut off the ear of the servant and the Lord has healed it, and when they arrest Jesus, at one point when he tells them he is Jesus, they all just fall backwards and fall down. And he says to them, why did you come with all these staves and swords? I'm in your temple every day. In other words, I've not been hiding from you. Why do you think you need all this to arrest me? And you know what the Bible says? That they all scattered. Now that had been prophesied way back in the Old Testament. But when the arrest really took place, all of a sudden, if you look, slipping into the dark, there went Thomas. I think that was Nathaniel who went. Oh, look, there's Judas. He's already gone. But now the other Judas, there went Simon. My goodness, there goes actually John. And James. And Peter. He's standing alone. Now, I've got to tell you, I don't think we look too good with Jesus being arrested and we're creeping off into the dark. Now, you say, that was then. But if you've never creeped off into the dark, you must be a mighty warrior. Sometimes the battle can get so rough that you can be like these disciples. They get out of the will of the Lord simply from being human. Now, the Lord knew they were going to scatter. There's a lot of pressure on a person. You stand in a garden with Roman soldiers arresting your leader and getting ready to crucify them And see if you just jump up there beside them and say, well, that's my leader, that's Jesus. The human wants to protect his life. And so they slipped away like the scripture said they would. And James and John are already in the mode of thinking, if he's going to die and have a new kingdom, then let us be the right hand and the left hand in that kingdom. Let's bark out all the others and just let us be the ones that are his main men. That's a selfish attitude, I do. And then you've got Peter. Where is Peter? Well, Peter is, he's standing outside down there in the yard. And you all know that when somebody says, that's one of them, he says, I am not. And when they say he sounds like a Galilean, he says, I am not. And the third time they asked him if he was belonged with Christ, he cursed and said he was not. And now if you look at Peter, who preached to us this morning, you'll not only see him creeping off in the dark, but you'll see his shoulders moving as he sobs. He is a mess. He is weeping bitterly. He is so sorry he let the Lord down. What's your point? Well, why are you telling us these horrible stories about the disciples? Because sometimes you and I forget. We mess up sometimes. Sometimes we are not the super Christians that we want to be. Sometimes you say something you didn't think you would ever say. True or not, right or not, sometimes it's out before you've got control of it. Sometimes you have battled something until you're worn and you're frustrated and you're tired and you begin to lose the real sight of where you're going. The burdens of life can pull you down. But listen, don't stop there. Don't ever stop in this battle. Don't ever stop here and look at the hill and say how big it is. And sit down in the valley and sit there. Because when the floods come, they're going to hit the valley. And if you stay down there in the valley, the floods of life will wash you away. You've got to keep on climbing. Your vision is to keep on moving. Now follow these men for just a little bit and see if we have a right to accuse them or not. Have you ever heard a person say something they didn't say? And for just a little bit you thought, well, they're not the person I thought they were. You know, up on your little righteous high horse and you look at them and judge them and guilty. Have you ever watched somebody and you think, man, they're not going to make it. They're not going to make it. But follow these men. Follow James. Just a few years later, he was in the upper room when the day of Pentecost came. He was filled with the Holy Ghost. And he had the power to be a witness. And the Bible tells us he was a great part of the leadership in the early church. So much a part of the leadership that when Herod decided to kill somebody as an example, he picked James. Now, let's go see James at his last day. Can you see this big, tall disciple standing in the halls of judgment where Herod has sentenced him to death because he says Jesus is the Christ? Can you see him as perhaps they let some of the family come and see him? It was traditional to let people at least speak to you before you died. Can you hear his words when he says, I'm not going to sell Jesus out. I'm going to die just the way I live it. I know that Jesus is the Christ. I know who he is. I walked with him and I talked with him. And though I have failed him at times, I know he is the Christ. a sword or an axe. Can you hear this man? I'm made to believe he prayed to Jesus. I'm made to believe that he had heard enough from the Lord that he probably even said, Father, Jesus, you gave your spirit into the Father's hand. Please give me courage to do this, Lord. Give me courage to go out as a Christian. Give me courage to be calling your name. I don't know what he said, but I can picture this man as he faces death as a strong Christian man as they separate his head from his body. And the first apostle is home. His spirit now is gone home. He's not got a seat at the right or the left, but he, I think, has one pretty close by. I may believe that there's 12 for the new and 12 for the old. It tells us there are 24 elders. It never does tell us exactly that those are New Testament and Old Testament. But we do know that in heaven, there are 12 gates, naming old, and there are 12 foundations, naming new. And I may believe James will be seated on one of those seats. I don't know where. I don't know which one, but I made him believe the first one to arrive home. He made it home. When you judge him on one day of his life, that doesn't tell you who he really is. And if you go to John, you got to follow John through 90 years of service. 90 years, this young man, he was a young man, the youngest of the disciples. He did outrun Peter to the grave. He was a man that we hear a lot about. That John was the one who laid on Christ's breast when they were lounging around eating. He was the one that was very close to the Lord. He wrote a book telling us a lot about the Lord. But he lived past all the other apostles were told. He lived so long that he's finally an old, old man. And he's still teaching and preaching the gospel. So much that the Lord says to the Father, or the Father says to the Son, we need somebody to write about the end of time. We need somebody to write about what was and what is and what's coming. Do you think we could go down and inspire John and let him become John the Revelator? And let him write the book of the Revelation? Couldn't we go out there on Patmos and inspire him and let some of those prisoners near him pen the words of the Revelation? And so there John is. And at the end of his life, about 100 years or so, somewhere in there, I don't know how old, John takes his last breath. And now John is home. Again, I don't think John has a seat here or here, but I think John the Beloved. John was allowed to write the book of John and tell us personal things about Jesus. He was allowed to write 1st and 2nd and 3rd John to some church problems. And then he was allowed to write the Revelation. I believe one of those seats out here belongs to Brother John. And what about Peter? If you go look at Peter on this night, Peter looks pretty bad, doesn't he? A sobbing, crying fisherman, servant, apostle. Why are you crying, Peter? Because I just denied that I ever knew Christ. I denied that I was the apostle. And I'm broken hearted about it. But then you see him later as he leads the church. And on the day of Pentecost, whenever the Spirit comes into the room and he begins to preach, and he preaches that great message, and 3,000 people are saved. And if you follow him through the book, and he gets his feet on the rock, and he gets his mind lined out, and he gets his heart and his soul straightened out, and you can walk behind Peter the rest of the way. And my daddy says you won't see a bottle. He's got it figured out. Sometimes when the valley is long and the valley is deep, don't count yourself out. You're not home yet. You remember the old story about the missionary? I don't know if you've all heard that one or not, but I'd like to share it here. There's a story about a missionary that had been on a long, hard trip. And he had been in a land where there was almost no accommodations for human beings. And he had been there a lot of years and had sacrificed much. His wife had died there. His children had all come back to the mainland. And he had still stayed there to minister. And he finally came home. He was on a ship. And the ship pulled into harbor. And he could just see the people lined up on the shore. They were just lined up as far as you could see. And he thought, wow, isn't this nice? Look how many people have come to welcome me home. They know I've been out serving the Lord. And they're here to welcome me home. And when the ship docked, put out the gangplank, and as he started moving toward it, people pushed him back and pushed him back and pushed him back. And they said, make way, make way, make way. And out comes some celebrity. And the celebrity passed off, and the crowd all greeted him and cheered, and the crowd all disappeared. And when he got off the gangplank, there was not one person to welcome him home. He started being in a valley. And he said, Lord, I spent all that time. That person, all they did was sing some songs or whatever, be famous. I've served you all this time, and there's not anybody to greet me. And the Lord said, you're not home yet. You're not home yet. Don't ever count yourself out in the valleys. Don't ever let the devil count you out in the valleys. I've seen some pretty deep valleys. And I've seen some times that I didn't know how I was going to come out. And if you would have seen me on those days, you would have said, look at that mess. As somebody says, there's a hot mess. Look what a mess. Supposed to be a minister of the gospel. Look at that hot mess. Lack of faith and saying things they shouldn't say. Sometimes my daughter-in-law will tell you that if that stroke thing is to work on me, I tell you the truth without any sugar. She says, as long as I'm healthy and well, I put some good sugar on stuff. She says she likes to hear me sometimes whenever I'm playing, when I'm tired of playing, because that I speak plainly. But I always worry about that. Even though I'm not saying bad stuff, I'm saying it too straight and too plain. Have you ever said things too straight and too plain and they didn't minister because they were harsh? There have been days that I wasn't proud of that. And don't judge me yet. I'm not home yet. I'm not home yet. Amen. And that mountain up in front of me, I plan to keep on climbing. I plan to put one foot in front of the other until the Lord meets me and says, come on home. Don't count yourself out, people. As we get a song, don't ever let the devil count you out. There's a lot of good Christian people in the Bible that you could have looked at on one day of their life and thought everything was bad. I've seen people in the throes of death of their family members, that maybe they got carried away with what they said to the people taking care of them. It wasn't their heart speaking, it was their fear of losing them. Don't ever let a valley, don't ever let the day that you don't look so good. Don't ever let that day define you. You just keep on. You ask forgiveness, ask for strength. Ask for faith. I wrote 9 things this morning. And just keep on trusting. Because you're not all here. As we stand, if anybody would like to pray, you come. We'll pray with you. anyway, if you want to pray, you come. I feel it.